እንዴት ናችሁ የተከበራችሁ የዩቲዩብ ቻናል ቤተሰቦች? ይህ ኢትዮ ዩኒቨርሲቲ ኤግዛም ሶሉሽን ሀብ ዩቲዩብ ቻናል ነው። እኔ መምህር ገታሁን ነኝ ከወላይታ ሶዶ ዩኒቨርሲቲ። በዚህ ዩቲዩብ ቻናል ላይ የተለያዩ ለማውጫ ፈተና የሚሆኑ ቪዲዮዎችን እየሰራሁ አቀርባለሁ። በዚህ ቪዲዮ ለሜካኒካል ምህንድስና ተማሪዎች የሚሆን የቴም 2 ላይ ስፔሻሊ በኢንጂነሪንግ ተርሞዳይናሚክስ፣ ሂት ትራንስፈር፣ ሪፍሪጅሬሽን ኤንድ ኤር ኮንዲሽኒንግ እና በፍሉድ ሜካኒክስ ላይ መሰረት ያደረጉ ጥያቄዎችን ሰርቼላችሁ አምጥቻለሁ። ሶ ይሄን ቪዲዮ እስከ መጨረሻ እንድታዩና ቪዲዮውን ጓደኞቻችሁም ሼር እንድታደርጉ በቪዲዮቹ ላይ ኮሜንት እንድጽፉና ለዩቲዩብ ቻናልም አዲስ ከሆናችሁ ሰብስክራይብ በማድረግ የዩቲዩብ ቻናል ቤተሰብ እንድትሆኑ እጋብዛለሁ። ቀጥታ አሁን ወደ ጥያቄዎች እገባለሁ። A dash is defined as a quantity of matter or a region in space chosen for study. A surrounding, B system, C mass, D boundary. Take this as C. So C mass, D boundary. So the correct answer is system. The correct answer is system. This is from the concept of thermodynamics. From the concept of thermodynamics. When we say this system, it is defined as a quantity of matter or a region in space chosen for the study, and the mass or region outside the system is called the surrounding. So this the mass or the region outside the system is what we call it, the surrounding. And when you say boundary, it is a real or imaginary surface that separates the system from its surrounding. So system or surrounding milayo line, that is boundary balal. እኛ የመረጥነው ፓርቷ ብቻ ሲስተም ትባላለች። ለጥናት የምንመርጣት ፓርቷ ሲስተም ትባላለች። ዘን ከሲስተም ውጪ የሆነ ደግሞ ሰራውንዲንግ በመባል ይታወቃል ማለት ነው። ሶ ዘ ኮሬክት አንሰር ኢስ ቢ። ኳስቲን ነምበር 3 ኤኒ ቼንጅ ዛት አ ሲስተም አንደርጎስ ፍሮም ዋን ኢኩሊብሪየም ስቴት ቱ አናዘር ኢስ ኮልድ ኤ ፕሮሰስ፣ ቢ ፕሮፐርቲ፣ ሲ ስቴት፣ ዲ ሲስተም። So here, any change that a system undergoes from one equilibrium state to another is called A process, B property, C state, D system. So this situation is what we call it process. It is best described by the term process. So when you say process, any change that a system undergoes from one equilibrium state to another is called what? Process. And the series of this state through which a system passes during a process is called the path of the process. Okay, so the correct answer is the change that a system undergoes from one equilibrium state to another is called process. This process is the correct answer. Next, Carnot cycle is the most efficient cycle operating between two specified temperature limits, and however, this the Carnot cycle is not a suitable model for power cycle. Which of the following impracticalities are associated with Carnot cycle? A, limiting the maximum temperature in the cycle. B, limits the thermal efficiency. C, the quality of the steam decreases during isentropic expansion process. D, all of the above. So the correct answer for this is D, all of the above. All of the above. Here, when you say Carnot cycle, and the Carnot cycle is the most efficient cycle operating between two specified temperature limits, but it is not suitable model for power cycles because here we can visualize from this image. Process 1 to 2, 1 to 2 means from this point to this point, limiting the heat temperature process to two-phase system severally limits the maximum temperature that can be used in the cycle. Here, this process 1 to 2, process 1 to like, here it's limiting the heat transfer process to two-phase system, severally limits the maximum temperature that can be used in the cycle. And from process 2 to 3, the turbine cannot handle steam with a high moisture content because of the impingements of liquid droplet on the turbine blade causing erosion and wear here. From this process 4 to 1, it is not practical to design a compressor that handles two phases. So here, in this case, in figure 2, here 1 to 2 is isothermal heat addition in a boiler, 2 to 3 is isentropic expansion in a turbine, 3 to 4, that means this to this, is isothermal heat ejection in a condenser, and 4 to 1, which is isentropic compression in a compressor. So this is what Carnot cycle, Carnot vapor cycle. So due to this all reasons, this Carnot cycle is not suitable model for our cycles. So the correct answer is D, all. In all case, explains that Carnot cycle is not applicable or not suitable for models in power cycle. Next, the food compartment of refrigerator is maintained at 4 degrees Celsius by removing heat from it at a rate of 360 kJ per minute. If the required power input to the refrigerator is 2 kW, determine the coefficient of performance of the refrigerator. So how we can determine this? እዚህ ጋር የተጠየቅነው ምንድነው የrefrigerator coefficient of performance ነው የተጠየቅነው. So here we have given parameters to calculate this, the coefficient of performance. The room represent the high temperature reservoir, while the freezer represent the low temperature reservoir to the refrigerator. So the coefficient of performance of the refrigerator is calculated by using this the ratio of desired effect to net work done or net work. So here we have QL, which is desired effect, and we have also work net. We have work net network, which is on the refrigerator. So ለዚህ እዚህ ጋር heat removed የተደረገው heat rate ስንት ነው? 360 kJ per minute ሰጥቶናል. So work input power ተሰጥቶናል 2 kW ነው.
ስለዚህ ይሄ በስንት ነው? በሚኒት ነበር ይሄ? ይሄ በሚኒት ነው. ሶ በ60 per second መሆን አለበት በ60 ማባዛት አለብን ማለት ነው. ሶ ይሄን ካልኩሌት እናደርግ. Here we have 360 over 2 ማለት ነው. So it's 60 የሚኒቱን ወደ ሰከንድ ስንቀይር በ60 ማባዛት ስለአለብን ነው. So ይሄን ስንሰራ ምናገኘው 3 ይሆናል ማለት ነው. So 360 በዚህ ስንት ነው የሚሆነው? 6 ይሆናል. 6 ለ2 3 ይቀራል ማለት ነው. So the correct answer or the coefficient of this the performance of the refrigerator is 3 ይሆናል ማለት ነው. So coefficient to 3 ይሆናል.
Next, a liquid that is about to vaporize is called A, compressed liquid, B, saturated vapor, C, saturated liquid, D, subcooled liquid. So the correct answer is C. So when we say this saturated liquid here, we have different classification of liquid, compressed liquid or subcooled liquid. Minilacho, a substance that it's not about to vaporize. When we say subcooled liquid, it is a substance that it is not about to vaporize. And when we say this saturated liquid, it is a liquid that is about to vaporize. And the other, when we say this saturated vapor, it is a vapor that is about to condense. And when we say this saturated liquid vapor mixture, that is what the state at which the liquid and the vapor phase coexist in equilibrium. And when we see the other type, superheated vapor, it is a vapor that is not about to condense. That means it is not a saturated vapor. So these are the classifications. So from the perspective of this, when you say this a liquid, it is about to vaporize, is what we call it the saturated liquid. Next, which one of the following is not intensive property of a system? A, temperature, B, pressure, C, density, D, total mass. So this total mass is not intensive property. The other temperature, pressure, and density are what intensive properties. Intensive properties. So the correct answer for this is D. Here, the explanation. We have two basic categories of thermodynamic property based upon the mass of the system, or depending upon the mass of the system. The first one is extensive, and the second one is intensive properties. And when you say extensive property, these are properties depending on the mass of the system, such as this mass, volume, internal energy, enthalpy, entropy, and this their values change according as the mass of the system change. So extensive property means that the system mass is dependent on the mass of the system, the value of the ሚቀየር ኦር ምናገኛቸው ቫልዩ ሚቀየርባቸው ሲስተሞች ዴ አር ኤክስቴንሲቭ ፕሮፐርቲ ብለን እንጠራለን። ኢንቴንሲቭ ፕሮፐርቲ ምንላቸው ደግሞ ዴ አር ኢንዲፔንደንት ኦፍ ማስ ኦፍ አ ሲስተም like this pressure, temperature, density, specific volume, specific internal energy, specific enthalpy, and specific entropy. These are what? Intensive properties. So from the given question here, we are asked to differentiate which one is not intensive property. So this temperature, pressure, and density all are intensive property, but this total mass is not intensive property. So this is correct answer. Next, temperature difference is the driving force for heat transfer. And the larger the temperature difference, and the higher the rate of heat transfer, A through B force. So the correct answer is true. So as we know, this temperature difference is the driving force for any heat transfer. And the heat transfer from this concept, the larger where we increase the, or the larger the temperature difference, the higher the rate of heat transfer. The higher the rate of heat transfer. So this it is true. Here the driving force for any form of heat transfer is the temperature difference, and the larger the temperature difference, the larger the rate of heat transfer. So the correct this statement is true. Next, water boils at 100 degrees Celsius. A true, B false. So is it true or false? So the correct answer is it is not always true. So it is false. It is false because here water freezes at 0 degrees Celsius and boils at and evaporates at 100 degrees Celsius only at atmospheric pressure. But atmospheric pressure beyond which and the zero on Michelin. But change in pressure affects the boiling and melting point of the water. Atmospheric pressure calone, the boiling and melting temperature. For example, when a pressure is decreased, the boiling point of water decreases. And it meaning that the water boiled or it gets boiled at a temperature lower than 100 degrees Celsius. So here depend on the temperature, boiling temperature depend on, or boiling or melting temperature depend on the pressure. For example, pressure betam kekenese boiling point of water ikenesal malatun. Boiling point of water kenese malat demo uha ke 100 degrees Celsius betach bonem degrees Celsius boil lihon ichilal malat no. It is true if and only if the question is, or the question includes atmospheric pressure. He true lihon michilaw tiyaqo lay atmospheric pressure yemil kale bicha no mihono malat no. Eziga the water boils at 100 degrees Celsius and at atmospheric pressure bil noro eziga true yihonal malat no. But basically atmospheric pressure yun belela pressure yun aitawqam. So the correct answer is false for this question. Next, which one of the following is ideal cycle for spark ignition reciprocating engines? A. Diesel cycle, B. Brayton cycle, C. Rankine cycle, D. Otto cycle. The ideal cycle for or the ideal cycle for spark ignition reciprocating engine is what? Otto cycle. Otto cycle. So when we say this Otto cycle, it is the theoretical cycle of interest when one is considering reciprocating spark ignition or SI engines, and the four stroke Otto cycle is made up of the following four internally reversible processes in any Otto cycle: isentropic compressor, isentropic expansion, and kenenyi yetesarra yonal malatna kenzi yetesarra no processu ka andu let alle ka let sost alle ka sost arat alle malatno arat stages allo. So ehe four stroke Otto cycle yemennelo. Therefore, this the correct answer for this question is here. The ideal cycle for spark ignition reciprocating engines, it is Otto cycle. So the correct answer is D. This is what the Otto cycle. Next question. Which one of the following is basic dimension? A. Energy, B. Pressure, C. Temperature, D. Velocity. So the correct answer is C. Temperature. Temperature is it is basic dimensions, but the others are driver dimensions. So here, primarily we have basically seven class jamran menawqo concept so primarily we have seven basic fundamental dimensions. These are mass, thanks, time, temperature, electric current, amount of light, and amount of matter also. These are what primary dimensions, and the other is secondary dimension. When in secondary dimension, because the drive argan menagenyacho dimension ochinacho malet. So from the listed one, the primary dimension is only temperature. This temperature is the primary dimension. The others, energy, pressure, and velocity, driver dimension or secondary dimension menilacho nacho.
From the following statement, which one is statement describes this Clausius second law? A, as the temperature approaches absolute zero, the entropy of the system approaches a constant minimum. B, it is impossible for a self-acting machine to transfer heat from a colder body to a hotter one without the aid of an external agency. C, it is impossible to design an engine that extracts heat and fully utilizes it into work without producing any other effect. And D, energy can neither be created nor destroyed, and it can only change forms. In any process, the total energy of the universe remains the same. So from this, which one is, statement describes this Clausius second law? So the correct answer is B. The statement at B describes this the Clausius second law. So when we say this Clausius statement, it says that, or it is stated that it is impossible to construct a device which operates in a cycle process and produces no effect other than transfer heat from one reservoir at low temperature to another reservoir at high temperature. So this statement points out the essence of work input required in refrigeration and heat pumps. And alternatively, it is impossible for a self-acting machine working in a cyclic process unaided by external agency to transfer heat from a body at higher temperature to a body at lower temperature. Or we can say that heat cannot flow from a colder body to a hotter body. This is what the general truth. So this is what the Clausius statement. So based upon or from the given alternatives, the one statement which best describes this Clausius statement is the statement described at B, which is it is impossible for a self-acting machine to transfer heat from a colder body to a hotter body, one, without the aid of an external agency to move or to transfer heat from colder body to the hotter body, we have to use or we have to apply another external aid or external force, and unless and otherwise we cannot transfer heat from the colder body to the hotter one. So this is what the Clausius second law. Next, during a steady flow process, fluid properties within this control volume may change with position, but not with time. But A false, B true. So the correct one for this is, it is true. So during a steady flow process, the fluid properties within a control volume may change with position, but not with time. So here we have steady and unsteady flow. We have steady and unsteady flow. When we say this steady flow, the steady flow process is a process where the fluid properties cannot change from point to point in the control volume, but remains the same at any fixed point during the whole process. And the steady flow process is characterized by the following: no properties within the control volume change with time. So, bezino mitawoko, there is no property which is changing within that the control volume with time. So, the correct answer is this B, it is true. So for a steady flow process, the fluid properties within a control volume may change with position, but not with time. So in case of this unsteady flow, this fluid properties change with time. Saatu betekayere kutur, fluid properties chum yetekayeru imetallu malet no. So this is what unsteady. But in this case, in a steady case, there is no fluid property change within or with respect to that time. So it is true. The next, a change in the state of a gas during which the pressure of the gas remains constant is called dash change. A, adiabatic, B, isobaric, C, isochoric, D, isothermal. So the correct answer is this B. It is isobaric change. When you say isobaric, it is with constant pressure
isochoric, it is constant volume. Isothermal, which is constant temperature. And adiabatic, which is no heat transfer. Adiabatic corner, heat transfer yellam maletno. So these are what the processes or the systems. So in this case, we have this constant pressure. We have constant pressure. So during this case, we have isobaric change. Next, which method increase the thermal efficiency of simple ideal Rankine cycle on which steam power plant operates? A, lowering the condenser pressure. B, superheating the steam to high temperatures. C, increasing the boiler pressure. D, all. So here, the correct answer for this is all. In all case, the thermal efficiency of the simple ideal Rankine cycle is increased. So here, when we see this, each one, lowering the condenser pressure. Lowering the condenser pressure allows for a greater temperature difference between the heat source, that means the boiler, and the heat sink, which is condenser. And this increase the cycle's thermal efficiency according to the Carnot efficiency equation. And the other, when we come to this choice B, superheating the steam to high temperature, this way we superheat the steam, which increases the average temperature at which heat is added to the working fluid, thus which increases the thermal efficiency by allowing for more work to be extracted from the steam in the turbine. So this also increases the efficiency. The other is increasing the boiler pressure. When we increase the boiler pressure, it also increases the average temperature at which heat is added to the working fluid. So this in turn increases the thermal efficiency by widening the temperature difference between the heat source and the heat sink. These all choices are the method to increase the thermal efficiency of the system. So the correct answer is D, all of the above. The next, heat is transferred to a heat engine from a furnace at the rate of 80 megawatt. And if the rate of waste heat rejection to a nearby river is 20 megawatt, determine the thermal efficiency of the heat engine. Or what is the thermal efficiency of heat engine? A, 50%, B, 25%, C, none, D, 75%. So the correct answer for this is D, 75%. How it could be? Here, we have QH, which is 80 megawatt, which is given. And here we have W net, and we have QL. This is rejection to the river, which is 20 megawatt. So to calculate this, the thermal efficiency of the heat engine, which is calculated as taking the ratio of net work output over heat input. And here we have 80, which is input, minus 20, which is rejected. That means the net work output. So the net work output is this 80, which is input, minus this 20, which is rejected. So 80 minus 20 over 80, which is 0.75 or 75%. So the thermal efficiency of the heat engine, which is the given specification, is 75% or 0.75. D is the correct answer. Next, consider the steady flow Carnot cycle with water as the working fluid. The maximum and minimum temperature in the cycle are 327 and 27 degrees Celsius. Determine the thermal efficiency. Or what is the thermal efficiency? A, 0.7, B, 0.4, C, 0.5, D, 0.6. So the correct answer for this is also this C, which is 0.5. And how we can calculate it? Here, to determine this, the thermal efficiency of Carnot cycle, we use this formula, thermal efficiency, which is 1 minus this temperature of cold over temperature of hot. These all are given. That means this T hot, which is the absolute temperature of the heat source, and T cold is the absolute temperature of the heat sink. So here we have given that the maximum temperature, that means heat hot, which is, this is in Kelvin unit. So 327 plus 273.15, which is this value. And in T cold is 27 plus 273.15, which is this value also. So by taking the ratio, the thermal efficiency is calculated as 1 minus 300.15 over 600.15, which is 1 minus 0.5, which is 0.5. So the thermal efficiency of this Carnot cycle is 0.5 or 50%. So the correct answer is 0.5 C ይሆናል ማለት ነው. Question number 18. Which one is not refrigeration cycle? A, Brayton cycle. C, idle vapor compression refrigeration cycle. D, reverse Carnot cycle. And C, reverse Carnot cycle. And D, reverse Brayton cycle. So from this, the alternative, this Brayton cycle is, not refrigeration cycle. So when we see this, the each choices, when with a Brayton cycle, this cycle is not a refrigeration cycle, and it is used in a gas turbine engine for power generation and propulsion. And in ideal vapor compression refrigeration cycle, this is a refrigeration cycle commonly used in household and commercial refrigerators, air conditioners, and heat pumps. And when you see this reverse Carnot cycle, this is a refrigeration cycle also. And when we come to this reverse Brayton cycle, this cycle involves work being done on the working fluid to transfer heat from a low temperature reservoir to the higher temperature reservoir. It is used in gas refrigeration and cryogenic system, making it a type of refrigeration cycle. So from the given one, this Brayton cycle is not the refrigeration cycle. The next, consider a gas mixture that consists of 3 kg of zero oxygen, 5 kg of nitrogen, and 2 kg of CH4. And determine the mass fraction of this value. So the mass fraction becomes 0.3. How we can calculate this, the mass fraction? How we can calculate the mass fraction here? To calculate the mass fraction, the total mass of the gas mixture is the summation of this all, which means 3 plus 5 plus 2, which is 10 kg. This 10 kg is the total mass. And to calculate this, the mass fraction of oxygen, this the mass fraction of oxygen is mass of oxygen over total mass. That means mass of oxygen, we have given 3 kg, and the total mass of this, so 3 over 10 kg, which is 0.3 honal malet no. So the correct answer for this, the mass fraction of oxygen is, in this gas mixture, is 0.3 or 30%. So basically, we set out measure that oxygen mass fraction of 0.3 honal malet no, or 30% honal. Next, a rigid tank contains 10 kg of water at 90 degrees Celsius, and if 8 kg of the water is in the liquid form and the rest is in the vapor form, determine the quality of the mixture. A, 1.25, B, 0.2, C, 0.8, and D, 1. So from this, the given alternative, the correct answer is B, the quality of this, the mixture is 0.2. How? Here, to determine the quality of the mixture, we can use this equation, quality, which is equal to total mass over mass of the vapor. And the mass of the vapor is here, total mass minus mass of liquid water, which is 10 minus 8 kg, which is 2 kilograms. So using the formula, this formula, 2 kg over 10, which is 0.2. So the quality of the mixture is 0.2. And therefore, the correct answer for this question is choice B. Choice B is the correct answer. This is the correct answer. The other, at pressure below the triple point value, the process of passing from the solid phase directly into the vapor phase is called A, sublimation, B, triple point, C, phase change, and D, melting. So this at pressure below the triple point value, the process of passing from the solid state directly into the vapor state is what we call the sublimation process. It is what is called sublimation. So when you say this, the sublimation, it is the process of passing from the solid phase directly into the vapor phase without passing through the liquid phase, which is usually called the sublimation process. So the sublimation is the correct answer. The next, the temperature at which condenser begins when air is cooled at constant pressure is A, dew point temperature, B, adiabatic saturation temperature, C, dry bulb temperature, and the D, wet bulb temperature. Therefore, the correct answer for this question is A, dew point temperature. This dew point temperature is the temperature at which condensation begins when air is cooled at constant pressure. Dry bulb, wet bulb, and dew point temperature are important to determine the state of this humid air And when we say this driver temperature, it refers basically to the ambient air temperature. And when we say this wet valve temperature, it is the adiabatic saturation temperature. And when we come to this dew point temperature, it is the temperature where water vapor starts to condense out of the air. Next, which term is related with the transfer of heat from a lower temperature region to the higher temperature one? A, work engine. B, heat engine. C, thermal engine. D, refrigeration. So the correct answer is this refrigeration. So the term refrigeration is related with the transfer of heat from a lower temperature region to higher temperature region. So this it is refrigeration. So here refrigerator and heat pump is in nature this heat flow from high temperature region to lower temperature one, and the reverse process however cannot occur by itself. So to do so we have to use some another external material. So the transfer of heat from low temperature region to the higher one requires a special device called this refrigerators. And these refrigerators are cyclic device and the working fluid used in the cycle are called refrigerants. So the term which is related with that of the transfer of heat from a lower temperature region to higher one is this refrigeration process. Next, dash the energy required to raise the temperature of a unit mass of substance by 1 degree. A, specific volume. B, specific enthalpy. C, specific work. And D, specific heat. Therefore, this when we say this specific heat, it is the energy required to raise the temperature of a unit mass of substance by 1 degree. So this is the correct answer. The correct answer is specific heat. And for example here, if by supplying the heat of Q to a substance of mass m and its temperature increased by change t, then this Q is directly proportional to that of mass times change t, or Q is directly proportional to cm times change t, where this C is constant of proportionality, which is what we call it specific heat capacity of the body. Therefore, now if we have m or mass is 1 and change in t is 1 degree Celsius, then Q is equal with this C. So the Q is equal with C. Therefore, the specific heat is the heat required to raise the temperature of a unit mass of a substance by 1 degree Celsius. So the correct answer is specific heat. Next, which one of the following is microscopic form of energy? A, internal energy. B, potential energy. C, kinetic energy. And D, mechanical energy. The correct one is this internal energy. So this internal energy is the form of what? Microscopic form of energy. It is microscopic form of energy. So the microscopic form of energy among the options provided is internal energy. And when we say this internal energy, it refers to the total energy contained with a system, including the kinetic energy of its particle and the potential energy associated with their position and interactions. So this internal energy is one of the special microscopic form of energy. The next, the amount of energy absorbed or released during a phase change process is called A, heat energy. B, latent energy. C, thermal energy. D, work energy. So here, the amount of energy released during the phase change process. So the correct answer is this latent energy. So when we say this latent energy, it is the energy observed or the energy absorbed or released by a substance during a phase change, such as this melting, vaporization, or sublimation without a change in temperature. And it represents the energy required to change the state of a substance without changing its temperature, that means with constant temperature. Next, which one of the following is true about the increase of entropy principle? A, the rate of generation of entropy, which is equal to zero for irreversible process. B, the rate of generation of entropy is zero for reversible process. C, the rate of generation of entropy is zero for impossible process. D, none of the above. So the correct one is this one. The correct one is this one. So the rate of generation of entropy for reversible process is zero. The entropy change of a system or its surrounding can be negative, but entropy generation cannot. So this, the entropy change of a system or its surrounding can be negative, but entropy generation cannot. So here, the rate of generation of entropy, which is greater than zero for irreversible process, which is equal with zero for reversible process, and which is less than zero for impossible process. So this is the situation for impossible process. This the rate of generation of entropy is less than zero. For reversible process, which is equal to zero, and which for irreversible process, which is greater than zero. So from this, the given alternative, this B is the correct answer. For the rate of generation of, or the true statement about increase of entropy principle is, the rate of generation of entropy for reversible process is zero. In this case, it is not correct, because the rate of generation of irreversible generation of entropy for irreversible processes, which is usually greater than zero, and for impossible, which is usually less than zero. So the correct one is B. Next, dash is the form of energy that is transferred between two systems or a system and its surrounding by virtue of temperature difference. A, heat; B, work; C, mass; D, temperature. So here, from this heat is the form of energy that is transferred between two systems by virtue of temperature difference. The energy transferred between the system and its surrounding as a result of temperature difference and energy as a heat passes from warmer body with a higher temperature to a cooler body with a lower temperature. And molecules of this the warmer body through collision lose kinetic energy to those of the colder body. And the thermal energy is transferred here in case of heat flow, and until the average molecular kinetic energy of the two bodies become the same and until the temperature become equal. So the correct answer is heat. So this heat is transferred due to from the system or between the system and its surrounding as a result of what temperature difference. The next one, atmospheric pressure is measured by a device called A, thermometer; B, manometer; C, barometer; D, U-tube. So the correct one is B, barometer. So this barometer is a device which is used to measure the atmospheric pressure. The atmospheric pressure. So thermometer, it is to measure temperature. Manometer, it is to measure the pressure. And barometer, which is to measure the atmospheric pressure. And U2, which is, this is the one type of or classification of the manometer, which is used to measure pressure difference between two points in a system. Therefore, the device which is used to measure this atmospheric pressure is specifically barometer is that device. Next, which one of the following quantity is used to describe the amount of moisture the air holds relative to the amount of moisture the air cannot hold at the same temperature? A, specific humidity; B, specific absolute humidity; C, humidity ratio; and D, relative humidity. So from this, the correct answer for this question is D, relative humidity. So the relative humidity is the correct answer. So when I say this, the quantity used to describe the amount of moisture the air holds relative to the amount of moisture it cannot hold at the same temperature is relative humidity. And it's expressed as a percentage in represent the ratio of the actual amount of water vapor present in the air to the amount or the maximum amount of water vapor the air cannot hold at the same temperature, at the same temperature, at that temperature. So the correct answer is D, relative humidity. Next, energy can cross the boundary of a closed system in the form of A, work or mass; B, heat or work or mass; C, heat or work; D, heat or mass. We have three classification of this: the system, thermodynamic system; the closed system; open system; and isolated system. So here, when we say closed system, it's the energy can cross the boundary of closed system in the form of heat or work. There is no mass flow. There is no mass flow. So the energy can cross or across the boundary of the closed system in the form of heat, either heat or work, rather than this mass. There is no mass flow in closed system. But for open system, there is heat or work or mass flow also. But in isolated system, there is neither. A, you know, A lik adellem, B lik adellem, C, the closed system mass flow ayaregem. So there is no mass flow. It's incorrect. In the basic case, mass lalle lik adellem. Bezim case, mass lalle lik adellem.
So basic case, in closed system, the energy is transferred or it may be moved or across the boundary of the closed system only in the form of heat and work. Therefore, the correct answer is C. Next, a process during which there is no heat transfer is called A. Isothermal process, B. Isochoric process, C. Adiabatic process, and D. Isobaric process. So the correct answer is C. Adiabatic process. So here, when we say this isothermal process, this is a process where the temperature of the system remains constant. Temperature constant connect, isothermal process by membari taugal. Isochoric process, it's known as isovolumetric process. This is a process where the volume of the system remains constant. Basically, volume constant. Sihono, isochoric process minilo. Adiabatic process minilo demo. This is a process in which there is no heat transfer. There is no heat transfer. Heat transfer kalele. If there is no heat transfer within a system or in a system, it is what we call it adiabatic process. When we say this isobaric process, it is a process that occurs at constant pressure. If the pressure is constant, it is isobaric. If the temperature is constant, it is isothermal process. And if the volume is constant, it is isochoric process. But if there is no heat flow, it is adiabatic process. Therefore, the correct answer is this adiabatic process. The next, the buoyant force for a floating body passes through A. Centroid of volume of the body, B. Metacenter of a body, C. Centroid of displaced volume, and D. Center of gravity of the body. Therefore, the correct answer is this C is the correct answer. The buoyant force for a floating body passes through the centroid of displaced volume. So C is correct answer. So here when say this buoyant force for a floating body passes through the centroid of the displaced volume of fluid, which is also known as the center of buoyancy. So C is correct answer. Next, what is hydrostatic pressure distribution? A. The distribution of temperature in a fluid in motion. B. The distribution of pressure in a fluid in a motion. C. The distribution of temperature in a fluid at rest. And D. The distribution of pressure in a fluid at rest. Therefore, the correct answer is D. D. When we say this hydrostatic pressure, it is the distribution of pressure in a fluid at rest. At rest. So this hydrostatic pressure distribution refers to the way pressure varies within a fluid that is not in a motion, typically due to the force of gravity acting on the fluid. And it is a fundamental concept in a fluid mechanics, and it is described by Pascal's law, which states that the pressure at any point within a fluid at rest is the same in all directions and is proportional to the depth of the fluid at that point. Therefore, when you say this hydrostatic pressure distribution, it is the distribution of pressure of the fluid at rest. So D is the correct answer for this question. D is the correct answer. Next, which of the following is the best definition of density? A. The mass of an object per unit volume. B. The weight of an object per unit volume. C. The force of an object per unit volume. And D. The volume of an object per unit mass. Therefore, the density of a fluid is described as that of the mass of an object per unit volume. So density calculates mass over volume. So density is a measure of how much mass is contained in a given volume. So density is mass over volume. So A is this correct answer. A is correct answer for the question. Next, which of the following is a characteristic of irrotational flow? A. The fluid particles do not rotate about their own axis. B. The flow is steady with the velocity at any point remaining constant over time. C. The flow is uniform with the velocity at any point being the same in all directions. D. The fluid particle rotate about their own axis. Correct answer is A. The fluid particle do not rotate about their own axis. What the basic characteristics or the base characteristics of this irrotational flow. Therefore, here irrotational flow is a flow in which no element of the moving fluid rotate in any direction from one instant to the next, and therefore the only torque applied by shear force on the side of the fluid particle can cause it to rotate.
And in this case, the fluid particle move without rotating about their own axis. That means the velocity field is such that the fluid undergoes no rotational motion within the flow. Therefore, the correct characteristic or the correct answer for this question is regarding this, the characteristics of fluid flow or irrotational flow is, well, the fluid particle do not rotate about their own axis. So this A is correct answer. Next question, which of the following is true about streamline? A, streamline never cross each other. B, streamline are smooth curve that follow the path of fluid particle. C, all of the above. D, streamline are tangent to the velocity vector at any point. So from this, which one is correct? So the correct answer for this question is correct. All of the above are the characteristics of this streamline, the characteristics or true about streamlines. Here, this is a streamline. When you say streamline, it is like this flow. And streamline is a path traced out by a massless particle moving with the flow. And velocity tangent to streamline at any point. And mass doesn't cross these streamlines. So here, from explanation also, here, when you say this streamline never cross each other, they never cross each other. This is generally true. And this streamline are smooth curves that follow the path of the fluid particle. This is also true. And when we say this D, streamline are tangent to the velocity vector at any point, this statement is true for steady, incompressible flow. At any given point, the velocity vector of this fluid tangent to the streamline passing through that point. So these all are the correct answers. The next, what is Bernoulli principle? What is Bernoulli principle? A, the pressure of a fluid decreases as its velocity increases. B, the pressure of fluid is inversely proportional to its velocity. C, the pressure of fluid is constant regardless of its velocity. D, the pressure of fluid increases as its velocity increases. So from this, which one best describes this Bernoulli principle? We have description. So the Bernoulli principle says that an increase in speed of a fluid occurs simultaneously with a decrease in pressure or decrease in the fluid potential energy. So Bernoulli principle can be derived from the principle of conservation of energy also. It is said that steady flow, the sum of all form of energy in a fluid will be the same at all point of that streamline. So from this, the given alternative, the correct one about this Bernoulli principle is this one. So the principle of this, the pressure of a fluid decreases as its velocity increases. So pressure, velocity by chamberan kotor, pressure decrease ya regal malet. This is what the Bernoulli principle mean alone. Which of the following is the best definition of vacuum pressure? A, here none of the above. B, the pressure of a gas above atmospheric pressure. C, the pressure of a gas is in a vacuum. D, the pressure of a gas below atmospheric pressure. So from this, which one best describes this vacuum pressure? So the best description of this vacuum pressure is this one. So the pressure of a gas below atmospheric pressure. This vacuum pressure is the pressure of a gas below atmospheric pressure. So here we have this absolute pressure here. We have absolute local atmospheric pressure here. We have absolute pressure, this one, absolute pressure. This is from this point to this point, it is local atmospheric pressure. And from this point, it is absolute pressure. And the difference between this local atmospheric pressure and absolute pressure is what vacuum pressure means. So this is vacuum pressure. It is the difference between this atmospheric, local atmospheric pressure and absolute pressure. So this vacuum pressure is a measure of the pressure of a gas in a space where the pressure is lower than atmospheric pressure. And it is expressed as the negative gauge pressure, often in a unit of this millimeter of a mercury, or it may be expressed as a pascal. Therefore, the correct answer is this D. This, when we say vacuum pressure, it is the pressure of a gas below atmospheric pressure. Next, which of the following is the total acceleration of a fluid particle? A, the sum of convection acceleration and the local acceleration. B, the sum of pressure gradient and shear stress. C, the sum of static pressure and dynamic pressure. D, the sum of gravity force and viscous force. So the correct one is this A. When we say this total acceleration of a fluid particle, it is usually calculated as the sum of convective acceleration and the local acceleration. So A is correct answer. It is known that this total acceleration is the vector sum of convective acceleration vector and local acceleration vector. Here we have a mathematical formula to calculate this acceleration of a fluid as this the convective acceleration from this part and local acceleration from this part. So by using this formula, we can calculate this total acceleration. Next, which of the following is a vortex flow? A, a flow in which the fluid particle move in a part circular path. B, a flow in which the fluid particle move in a random manner. C, a flow in which the fluid particle move in a wavy manner. D, a flow in which the fluid particle moves in a straight line. So the correct one is this one. So when it's a vortex flow, it is a flow in which the fluid particle move in a circular path. So here, vortex flow refers to a type of fluid flow or fluid motion where the flow pattern is characterized by the formation of this swirling region or vortices, and in such flow, the fluid particle tend to move in circular or helical path around a central axis. The next, which of the following is a characteristic of steady flow? A, the fluid particle move in a random, chaotic manner. B, the fluid particle move in smooth parallel layer. C, the flow is uniform with the velocity at any point being the same in all directions. And D, the flow is steady with a velocity at any point remaining constant. Therefore, the true statement or the characteristics of this steady flow is the statement at D. That means it is characterized by the flow with the velocity at any point remaining constant over time. There is no velocity change over time. Here, the steady flow refers to a type of flow where fluid characteristics like velocity, pressure, density at a given point don't change with time, and despite any movement, their speed and direction remains constant over time at that point. Therefore, this is the correct one. And here we have the characteristics of this steady flow. So for this steady flow or a steady fluid flow is characterized by this part, this concept. So for a steady fluid flow, there is constant velocity, there is no acceleration, there is uniform fluid flow, there is predictable pattern, there is the streamlines remain unchanged, and there is conservation of mass and energy also. So these are what the characteristics of this steady fluid flow. Therefore, from the given alternative, the one which best describes this steady fluid flow characteristics is the flow is steady with the velocity at any point remaining constant over time. So D is the correct answer. Next, which of the following is the definition of dynamic viscosity? A, the force required to move a unit area of a fluid parallel to the second unit area of the fluid, a unit distance apart in a unit time. B, the ratio of the dynamic viscosity to the density of the fluid. C, the time it takes for a known amount of fluid to flow a given distance. D, the ratio of the shear stress to the shear rate. So the correct one is this one regarding this dynamic viscosity. So when you say dynamic or absolute viscosity, it is the tangential force per unit area required to move one horizontal plane with respect to another plane at a unit velocity when maintaining an unit distance apart in the fluid. So the correct one is this choice A. Next, which of the following is the main difference between a simple manometer and differential manometer? A, simple manometer uses a single leg, while differential manometer uses two legs. B, a simple manometer is less expensive than differential manometer. C, a simple manometer measures the pressure of a single point, while this differential manometer measures the pressure difference between two points. And D, a simple manometer is more accurate than a differential manometer. Okay, so this is the correct answer. So when you say simple manometer, this is type of manometer which is used to measure the pressure of a single point in a fluid system relative to the surrounding pressure. And when you say this differential manometer, it is a manometer used to designed to measure the major difference between two points with a fluid system. Therefore, the basic difference is this one. So the correct answer for this question is this choice C. The basic difference between this simple manometer and differential manometer is A simple manometer is used to measure the pressure of a single point, while or whereas this differential manometer measures the pressure difference between two points. So C is the correct answer. Next, which of the following is the best definition of dynamic viscosity? A, the resistance of a fluid flow. B, the ease with which a fluid flow. C, the velocity of a fluid. D, the force required to move a fluid. Therefore, the correct answer for this is this one. This dynamic viscosity is the resistance of a fluid flow. When you say dynamic viscosity, it is a measure of fluid's resistance to flow, and it describes how easily or difficulty a fluid deforms or flows when subjected to an applied force or shear. So this dynamic viscosity is a measure of fluid's resistance to flow. So the correct answer is A. Next, which of the following is the definition of kinematic viscosity? A, the ratio of dynamic viscosity to the density of the fluid. B, the time it takes for a known amount of fluid to flow a given distance. C, the ratio of shear stress to the shear rate. D, the force required to move a unit area of fluid parallel to a second unit area of fluid a unit distance apart in a unit time. Therefore, the correct statement about this kinematic viscosity is it is the ratio of dynamic viscosity to the density of the fluid. So A is the correct answer for this question. So when you say this kinematic viscosity, it is an atmospheric variable defined as the ratio between the dynamic viscosity and density of the fluid, and it depends on both air temperature and pressure. So this is the correct answer. When you say dynamic kinematic viscosity, it is the ratio of dynamic viscosity to the density of the fluid. Next, which of the following is a characteristics of laminar flow? A, the flow is steady with the velocity at any point remaining constant over time. B, the fluid particle move in smooth and parallel layer. C, the flow is uniform with the velocity at any point being the same in all direction. And D, the fluid particle move in a random and chaotic manner. So from this, which one describes this laminar flow? So the one which describes laminar flow is this one. So when you say laminar flow, the fluid particle move in smooth and parallel lines. So here, this is laminar flow and this is turbulent flow. When you say laminar flow, the fluid particles move in form of smoothly and line form. So here we have characteristics of laminar flow as the fluid flow is smooth and ordered. There is low Reynolds number. There is the flow is predictable, and there is low energy dissipation as well as little mixing of the particles. So these are the characteristics or features of laminar fluid flow. So the correct answer for this is choice B. Laminar flow is characterized by their fluid particles move in smooth and parallel layers. There is also characteristics of turbulent flow. The flow is chaotic and irregular. There is high Reynolds number. The flow is unpredictable, and there is high energy dissipation as well as there is enhanced mixing of particles. So these are what the characteristics of turbulent flow. The other is, which of the following is the best definition of kinematic viscosity? A, the velocity of a fluid. B, the force required to move a fluid. C, the ease with which a fluid flow. And D, the resistance of a fluid flow. So from this, which one best describes kinematic viscosity? So the one which best describes kinematic viscosity is this one, the ease with which a fluid flow. So this kinematic viscosity is a measure of fluid's internal resistance to flow under gravitational force. And it is defined as the ratio of dynamic viscosity to its density of the fluid. Therefore, and this kinematic viscosity represents the fluid's resistance to flow relative to its mass, which provides a measure of how easily the fluid can flow under the influence of external force. So the correct answer for this is C. Kinematic viscosity is the ease with which a fluid flows. Next, which of the following is the stream function, or true about the stream function? A function that gives the temperature of a fluid. B, a function that gives the velocity of a fluid. C, a function that gives the velocity potential of a fluid. And D, a function that gives the pressure of a fluid. So the correct answer for this is B. When we say this stream function, they are a function that gives the velocity of a fluid. The velocity of a fluid. So here, a stream function is a mathematical function used in fluid dynamics to describe the velocity field of the fluid, and it is a scalar function that when we used in conjunction with the continuity equation and can fully describe the flow field of a fluid. And this streamline of the flow field are defined as the curve along which the stream function is constant. For the correct statement which describes this stream function is, it is a function that gives the velocity of the fluid. So this is the video in part one of this theme two. And I will come with other parties. I wish have a nice exit exam preparation time. And if you like this video, share the video for your friends. As well as if you are new for this YouTube channel, subscribe the channel and be a member of this channel and to access the tips from the channel. Thank you for watching this video. Thank you.